Tanter Audio presents The Girl in the Woods by Gregg Olsen. Narrated by Corey M. Snow. Prologue. Molly O'Rourke worked as a nurse's aide at a convalescent center in Silverdale, Washington, and loathed the early morning and weekend hours that came with the job. It wasn't what she'd envisioned at all. At 27, the petite redhead with sharp, angular features had expected that she'd be a bit further along at this stage. It was true she was no longer under her mother's roof, and that was a godsend, but she wasn't exactly moving along in life at a fast clip. She rented a slightly run-down house at 509 Camellia Street in Port Orchard, up on the hill overlooking the naval shipyard and its row of hulking gray ships awaiting repair or dismantling. She put a pencil to her budget and realized that the only way she could afford a better place was if she had a roommate or a boyfriend, but that wasn't going to happen. Not with her terrible hours. Molly wasn't a quitter, but a realist. She stood in the dim light of the parking strip in front of her 1940s house and ran every possible outcome for her life through her head. The list had very few pluses and a plethora of minuses. She'd completed her training from a quasi-university in downtown Bremerton and was saddled with what she had determined after graduation was minimal skills and maximum debt. Her mother had needled her for paying so much for an education that basically had her changing diapers on the elderly. "And you thought you were going to be a nurse," Mrs. O'Rourke said, in a cutting way that she'd perfected. "You should have stayed at the doctor's office where you were a receptionist and you had a decent meal benefit."
"I'm not being harsh. You know, honey doll, I always believed in you."
Honey doll was like a twisted dagger in the gut. That entire exchange came into Molly's head at a little after 4 o'clock Saturday morning as she stood with her dog while the pooch found a suitable spot on the fringe of a juniper bush in the parking strip. A late-night rain had left the asphalt black and shiny, and the lamp on her driveway cast a glistening puddle of light at her feet.
"Hurry up, Candy. I gotta get to work."
Molly tugged on the hot pink leash to redirect the dog to the duty at hand.
"Honestly, do you have to smell every little thing? Every single time? Can you just do your job so I can do mine?"
Candy, a miniature schnauzer with a decidedly independent streak, was not about to be rushed. Not ever. Her silver-furred face tilted at her owner with a look that was probably a kind of canine F.U., but the dog owner didn't take it that way at all.
"Be a good girl," Molly said, relaxing the length of the leash.
Just as hope had been all but dashed, Candy got her act together and squatted.
"Good girl,"
Molly said, satisfied that she might get to work on time. Molly looked up toward the top-to-bottom renovated house next door as lights in the upstairs bedroom sent a beam out into the early morning darkness. It was the home of her neighbors, Ted and Jennifer Roberts. The nurse's aide glanced at her phone. It was 4:15 a.m. She let out a sigh. Ted Roberts had been ill for months, seriously ill. There was a terrible irony to his downward spiral. He'd been a typical Northwesterner, the kind who fishes, skis, kayaks, and generally just lives his or her life in the elements, out in the abundance of outdoor-related activities that make the region the focus of so much attention by sports and lifestyle magazines. Molly admired Ted for doing all that he did. She was a TV watcher, not a doer. That, her mother told her, was one reason why she couldn't get a boyfriend. Or a decent one.
"No one wants to marry a couch potato, honey doll," she had said.
Molly knew that, but then again, her shift at work made doing anything but flopping in front of the TV out of the question. She hadn't had sex in more than a year. The encounter with an old boyfriend from high school hadn't been of the caliber to make her want a repeat. Ted Roberts had invited her to go kayaking one time when he was still single, but Molly didn't want to miss a reality TV marathon she'd been sucked into and passed on the opportunity. She wished now that she'd said yes. She liked Ted. So robust, so strong, so vital. As she stood there looking up at the lighted window, she caught a memory of how Ted had appeared before getting sick.
He was in his 40s, but his body surely didn't look it. That former classmate she'd hooked up with looked like he'd swallowed the Pillsbury Doughboy. Whole. Molly didn't go kayaking with Ted, but she kind of imagined he had been asking her out on a date. She'd never have said yes to that anyway. Not cool to date your neighbor. Not at all. "You only live once," he said when she declined his offer. If that was her window for the older guy next door, it snapped shut shortly thereafter. It was around that time that Jennifer and her son Micah and daughter Ruby showed up on the scene. Molly could see a change coming over her friend and neighbor. Even though he'd always had a smile on his face, a joke, a laugh, something that indicated a love of life, Ted Roberts hadn't really been happy at all. Oh, he looked like he was happy, but that wasn't genuine. Ted had even admitted one day the previous summer that he'd been filling up his time biking, running, and kayaking to escape the emptiness of his own life. "You got a boyfriend yet, Moll?" he asked her while he washed his Jeep on a sunny August afternoon. Molly looked away, embarrassed. "Not really," she said. "I've had a few maybes, but none that I'd ever go out with. The guys I see at work are super old, you know, in their 50s and 40s and stuff." Ted smiled. "Old like me?" he said. His eyes squinted and his gaze challenged her a little. His brow was a crinkled patch of sunburned skin. "That came out wrong," Molly said, her face feeling hot. He grinned and flashed his bright white teeth. "No worries," he said. "I'm going to tell you something very important." He motioned for her to come closer. "What?" Molly asked, leaning in, keeping an eye on the hose in case he was going to try to drench her in some Ted-like prank. "I didn't start living until I found Jennifer," he said. "Don't wait like I did. Sometimes the best thing is standing right in front of you." Molly was lonely and naive enough to think that he was kind of hitting on her. It was a thought she'd like expunged from her memory because he hadn't been doing anything of the sort. Yet for some reason the encounter came back to her while her dog squatted by the bush and the light came on in the bedroom. Ted was not like that at all. He was no flirt. He was deliriously happy that he had found Jennifer. With Candy now doing her little dance, flipping dirt and bark dust back toward the parking strip, Molly's thoughts drifted to the last time she saw Ted. It was about a week ago. She went over after work with the better part of a chocolate sheet cake. Jennifer answered the door. She was in her 40s too, but looked younger. She had a lovely figure, the kind Molly had always wanted. A little larger on top, but not so much that it distracted from her face. Her wrists and ankles were thin, which were always stops on Molly's survey of another girl. Her mother had piano legs, and so did she. "I thought you, Ted, and the kids might like this," Molly said. "They made me take it home. I guess they think I have no life, and it doesn't matter if I get fat. Anyway, you, all of you, are always so perfect." "Molly, you're so thoughtful," Jennifer said. "I'm sure Ruby and Micah will devour it." Maybe Ted, too," Molly said, almost as a question. Jennifer turned toward the living room. "Would you like to see him?" Molly didn't hesitate to get into the living room. It was the real reason she was there. The cake had been an excuse. She shut the door and followed Jennifer into a darkened living room, where the sole illumination came from the 70-inch big-screen TV. "You have a visitor, babe," Jennifer said. She turned to Molly and gave her a little look, a warning, it seemed. Molly could scarcely believe her eyes. Ted was covered in a Navajo blanket up to his neck. His eyes were slits. His face had shrunken to a kind of Edvard Munch gauntness. Even with the flickering glow, or especially because of it, he was a horrific sight. Ted couldn't even lift his head from the sofa to say hello. Jennifer stood next to him and stroked his pasty brow. "If it gets to the point that you can't stay home anymore, Teddy, I'm going to see that you are sent to Molly's nursing home." "I hope it doesn't come to that," Molly said, trying to lighten the mood. "Our cafeteria is all carbs and protein. He'll starve there." Ted attempted a smile. Jennifer handed him a water bottle. "Drink some iced tea," she said. "You're getting dehydrated, babe." Ted sipped slowly from the flexible straw that stuck out only a quarter of an inch from the top of the bottle. "You are getting better, aren't you?" Molly asked, her heart quickening a little. She'd seen people at the convalescent center who looked better than Ted, and they died.
"I think so," Ted said, his voice a slight croak. "Every day I do feel a little bit stronger."
He closed his eyes, and Jennifer motioned for Molly to come to the kitchen where she set the cake on the counter.
"Jennifer, he's going to be all right, isn't he?"
Jennifer opened the refrigerator and rearranged a dozen bottles of iced tea so she could accommodate the cake.
"I don't know, Molly," she said.
With the space barely big enough to accommodate it, Jennifer shoved the cake onto the top shelf. Molly could see that the back end of the cake had smashed the refrigerator wall.
"What exactly is wrong with him?" she asked.
Jennifer shook her head and shut the refrigerator. She had an irritated look on her face.
"By what? The cake or the question?"
"We don't know,"
she said, reaching for a towel to wipe off some chocolate that had smeared her palm.
"Cancer, maybe."
Molly kept her eyes riveted on Jennifer's.
"What do you mean, maybe?"
Jennifer started walking toward the front door to lead Molly from the kitchen, but the younger woman tugged at her shoulder.
"What do you mean?" she repeated.
Jennifer spun around.
"I mean, he won't go in to see the doctors anymore. Believe me, I've tried."
"Why won't he?"
Molly asked.
"He's afraid, Molly."
"Ted's not afraid of anything."
"You don't know him like I do."
It was a trump card of sorts, and Jennifer played it for all it was worth.
"Then tell me," Molly said. "What's he afraid of?"
Jennifer narrowed her focus. She didn't like being questioned by some neighbor.
"That if he goes to the doctor, he'll never come home again," she said.
Molly pounced.
"That's stupid."
"To you, maybe," Jennifer said. "But my husband is adamant."
Husband. It was odd that she referred to him as husband. Molly immediately saw it as a territorial move. "He's mine." Candy had a toy cat that she liked to hump, even though she was a female. It was about being territorial, staking a claim, saying something is mine. Jennifer was humping her sick husband.
"He might die, Jennifer," Molly said.
Jennifer went to open the door.
"There are worse things than dying," she said.
The young woman wanted to scream at Jennifer's obvious indifference. She knew better. Jennifer Roberts was not the type that anyone wanted to mess with. She was a woman who always got her way. Molly O'Rourke was not deeply religious, but she gave prayer a try after that encounter. She prayed over and over that God would heal Ted Roberts. Someone so full of life, so happy, shouldn't have to suffer. Chapter 1. Birdy Waterman went toward the ringing bell and an annoyingly insistent rat-tat-tat knock on the glass storm door of her home in Port Orchard, Washington. Her cell phone was pressed to her ear, and her fingertips fumbled in her pocket for her car keys. She retrieved a tube of lip balm, with the lid off and the product making a mess of her pocket.
"Great. Where are those keys?"
"Hang on," she said into the phone, grabbing a tissue and wiping off her hand. "Everything happens at once. Someone's here. I'll be there in 15 minutes. She swung the door open. On her doorstep was a soaking wet teenaged boy.
"Make that 20, she said, pulling the phone away from her ear.
It was her sister's son, Elon.
"Elon, what are you doing here?
Can I come in? He asked.
Hang on, she said, back into the phone. Wait, did I get the date wrong? She asked him.
The kid shook his head. Birdy looked past Elon to see if he was alone. He was only 16. They had made plans for him to come over during spring break. He hadn't been getting along with his parents, and Birdy offered to have him stay with her. She'd circled the date on the calendar on her desk at the Kitsap County Coroner's Office and on the one that hung in the kitchen next to the refrigerator. It couldn't have slipped her mind. She even made plans for activities that the two of them could do, most of which were in Seattle, a place the boy revered because it was the Northwest's largest city. To a teenager from the Macaw Reservation, it held a lot of cachet.
"Where's your mom?" Birdy asked, looking past him, still clinging to her cell phone.
The boy, who looked so much like his mother, Birdy's sister Summer, shook his head.
She's not here, and I don't care where she is.
How'd you get here?
I caught a ride and I walked from the foot ferry. I hitched, but no one would pick me up.
You shouldn't do that, Birdy said. Not safe.
She motioned him inside. She didn't tell him to take off his shoes, wet and muddy as they were. He was such a sight she nearly forgot that she had the phone in her hand. Elon, gangly but now not so much, was almost a man. He had medium-length dark hair, straight and coarse enough to mimic the tail of a mare. On his chin were the faintest of whiskers. He was trying to grow up. She turned away from the teen and spoke back into her phone.
I have an unexpected visitor, Birdy said.
She paused and listened.
Everything is fine. I'll see you at the scene as soon as I can get there.
Elon removed his damp, dark gray hoodie and stood frozen in the small foyer. They looked at each other the way strangers sometimes do. Indeed, they nearly were. Elon's mother had all but cut Birdy out of her life over the past few years. There were old reasons for it, and there seemed to be very little to be done about it. The sisters had been close, and they'd grown apart. Birdy figured there would be reconciliation someday. Indeed, she hoped that her entertaining Elon for spring break would be the start of something good between her and Summer. Her heart was always heavy when she and her sister stopped speaking. As the Kitsap County forensic pathologist, Dr. Birdy Waterman had seen what real family discord could do. She was grateful that hers was more of a war of words than weapons.
You are going to catch a cold, she said, and I have to leave right this minute.
Elon's hooded eyes sparkled. If I caught a cold, would you split me open and look at my guts? He asked. She half smiled at him and feigned exasperation.
If I had to, yes.
She'd only seen him a half dozen times in the past 3 years at her sister's place on the reservation. He was a smart aleck then, and he still was. She liked him.
I'll be gone a while. You are going to get out of all your wet clothes and put them in the dryer.
He looked at her with a blank stare.
What am I supposed to wear? He asked. You don't want a naked man running around, do you?
She ignored his somewhat petulant sarcasm.
Man? That was a stretch.
She noticed Elon's muddy shoes and the mess they were making of her buffed hardwood floors, but said nothing about that. Instead, she led him to her bedroom.
Uninvited guests, she said, then pretended to edit herself. Surprise guests get a surprise.
She pulled a lilac terry robe from a wooden peg behind her bedroom door.
This will have to do, she said, offering the garment.
Elon made an irritated face but accepted the robe. He obviously hated the idea of wearing his aunt's bathrobe, probably any woman's bathrobe. At least it didn't have a row of pink roses around the neckline like his mother's. Besides, no one, he was pretty sure, would see him holed up in his aunt's place.
Aunt Birdy, are you going to a crime scene? He asked. I want to go.
I am, she said, continuing to push the robe at him until he had no choice but to accept it.
But you're not coming. Stay here and chill. I'll be back soon enough. And when I get back, you'll tell me why you're here so early. By the way, does your mom know you're here?
He kept his eyes on the robe.
No, she doesn't. And I don't want her to.
That wasn't going to happen. The last thing she needed was another reason for her sister to be miffed at her.
Your dad? She asked.
Elon looked up and caught his aunt's direct gaze. His dark brown eyes flashed.
I hate him even more.
Birdy rolled her eyes upward.
That's perfect, she said. We can sort out your drama when I get back.
She put her hand up and cut him off.
Hungry? Frozen pizza is the best I've got. Didn't have time to bake you a cake.
She found her keys from the dish set atop a bird's-eye maple console by the door and went outside. It had just stopped raining. But in late March in the Pacific Northwest, a ceasefire on precipitation only meant the clouds were taking a coffee break. Jinx, the neighbor's cat, ran over the wet pavement for a scratch under her chin, but Birdy wasn't offering one right then. The cat, a tabby with a stomach that dragged on the lawn, skulked away. Birdy was in a hurry. She dressed for the weather, which meant layers, dark-dyed blue jeans, a sunflower-yellow cotton sweater, a North Face black jacket.
If it got halfway warm, she'd discard the North Face. That almost always made her too hot. She carried her purse, a raincoat, and a small black bag. Not a doctor's bag, really, but a bag that held a few of the tools of her trade. Latex gloves, a flashlight, a voice recorder, evidence tags, a rule, and a camera. She wouldn't necessarily need any of that where she was going, but Dr. Waterman lived by the tried and oh-so-true adage, better safe than sorry. As she unlocked her car, a Seattle-bound ferry plowed the slate waters of Rich Passage on the other side of Beach Drive. A small assemblage of seagulls wrestled over a soggy and very dead opossum on the roadside.
Aylin had arrived early. Not good.
Birdy pulled out of the driveway and turned on the jazz CD that had been on continuous rotation. The music always calmed her. She was sure that Aylin would consider it completely boring and hopelessly uncool, but she probably wouldn't like his music either. She needed a little calming influence just then. Nothing was ever easy in her family. Her nephew had basically run away, at least as far as she could tell. Summer was going to blame her for this somehow. She always did. As Birdy drove up Mile Hill Road and then the long stretch of Banner Road, she wondered why the best intentions of the past were always a source of hurt in the present. And yet the worst of it all was not her family, her nephew, or her sister. The worst of it was what the dispatcher from the coroner's office had told her moments just before Aylin arrived. A dismembered human foot had been found in Banner Forest. Chapter 2 Tracy Montgomery had smelled the odor first. The 12-year-old and the other members of Suzanne Hatfield's 6th-grade Olalla Elementary School class had made their way through the twists and turns of a trail understandably called tunnel vision toward the sodden intersection of Croaking Frog when she first got a whiff. It was so rank it made her pinch her nose like she did when jumping in the pool at the Y in nearby Gig Harbor.
"Ew, stinks here,"
the girl said in a manner that indicated more of an announcement than a mere observation. Tracy was a know-it-all who wore purple UGG boots that were destined to be ruined by the muddy late-March nature walk in Banner Forest, a Kitsap County park of 630-plus acres. She'd been warned that the boots were not appropriate for the sure-to-be-soggy trek inside the one-square-mile woods that were dank and drippy even on a sunny spring day. There was no doubt that Tracy's mother was going to survey the damage of those annoyingly bright boots and phone a complaint into the principal's office.
"That's why they call it skunk cabbage," said Ms. Hatfield,
a veteran teacher who had seen the interest in anything that had to do with nature decline with increasing velocity in the last decade of her 30-year teaching career. She could hardly wait until retirement, a mere 44 school days away. Kids today were all but certain that lettuce grew in a cellophane bag and chickens were hatched shaped like nuggets. Ms. Hatfield brightened a little as a thought came to mind. Her mental calculations hadn't been updated to take into account this day. Technically, she only had 43 days left on the job. A squirrel darted across the shrouded entrance to Croaking Frog, turned left, then right, before zipping up a mostly dead Douglas fir.
"My dad shoots those in our yard," Davy Saunders said.
The schoolboy's disclosure didn't surprise anyone. Davy's dad went to jail for confronting an intruder, a driver from the mattress ranch store in Gorst, with a loaded weapon. The driver's crime? The young man used the Saunders driveway to make a 3-point turn.
"Want to hear something really gross?"
This time the voice belonged to Cameron Lee. He was packed into the middle of the mass of kids and two beleaguered moms clogging the trail.
"My cousin sent me a video that showed some old guy cutting up a squirrel and cooking it. You know, like for food."
Ms. Hatfield considered using Cameron's comment as a learning moment about how some people forage for survival, but honestly, she was simply tired of competing with reality TV, the internet, and the constant prattling of the digital generation. They knew less and less, it seemed, because they simply didn't have to really know anything. Everything was always at their fingertips. Ms. Hatfield knew the Latin name for the skunk cabbage that had so irritated Tracy's olfactory senses, Lysichiton americanus, but she didn't bother mentioning it to her students. Instead, she sighed and spouted off a few mundane facts about the enormous leafed plant with bright yellow spires protruding from the muddy soil like lanterns in a dark night. "It smells bad for a reason," she said. "Anyone know why?" She looked around. Apparently, no one did. She glanced in the direction of Viola Mertz, but even she didn't offer up a reason. The teacher could scarcely recall a moment in the classroom when Viola didn't raise her hand. If she'd lost Viola, there was no hope. Ms. Hatfield gamely continued. "It smells bad to attract—" "Smells like Ryan, and he can't attract anyone," Cooper Wilson said, picking on scrawny Ryan Jonas whenever he could. Ms. Hatfield ignored the remark. Cooper was a thug, and she hoped that when puberty tapped Ryan on the shoulder, he'd bulk up and beat the crap out of his tormentor. But that would be later, long after she was gone from the classroom. "To attract pollinators," she went on, wondering if she should skip counting days left on the job and switch to hours. "Bugs, bees, flies, whatever." "I'm bored," Carrie Bowden said. Ms. Hatfield wanted to say that she was bored too, but of course she didn't. She looked over at one of the two moms who'd come along on the nature hike. Carrie's mom, a willowy brunette named Angie, who had corked earbuds into her ears for the bus ride from the school and hadn't taken them out since. Cooper Wilson's mom, Mariah, must be bored too. She flipped through her phone's email, cursing the bad reception she was getting. "It might smell bad," Ms. Hatfield said, trying to carry on with her last field trip ever. "But believe it or not, this plant actually tastes good to bears. They love it like you love a Subway sandwich." Only Cooper Wilson brightened a little. He loved Subway. "Indigenous people ate the plant's roots, too," the teacher went on. She flashed back to when she first started teaching and how she'd first used the word Indians, then Native Americans, and now Indigenous people. Lots of changes in 3 decades. "Skunk cabbage might smell bad," she said, "but it had very important uses for our Chinook people. They used the leaves to wrap around salmon when roasting it on the hot coals of an alderwood fire. I went to a luau in Hawaii, and they did that with a pig," Carrie piped up, not so much because she wanted to add to the conversation, but because she liked to remind the others in the class that she'd been to Hawaii over Christmas break. She brought it up at least once a week since her sunburned and lay-wearing return in January. "They wrapped it up in big green leaves before putting it into the ground on some coals," she said. "That's what they did in Hawaii." "Miss Hatfield," Tracy said, her voice rising above the din of not-so-nature lovers, "I need to show you something." Tracy always had something to say, and Miss Hatfield knew it was always super important. Everything with Tracy was super important. "Just a minute," the teacher said, a little too sharply. She tried to diffuse her obvious irritation with a quick smile. "Kids, about what Cameron said a moment ago," she continued, "I want you to know that a squirrel is probably a decent source of protein. When game was scarce, many pioneers survived on small rodents and birds." "Miss Hatfield, I'm seriously going to puke," Tracy called out. Her voice now had enough urgency to cut through the buzzing and complaining of the 2 dozen other kids on the field trip. Tracy knew how to command attention. Her purple Uggs were proof of that. Ms. Hatfield pushed past the others. Her weathered but delicate hands reached over to Tracy. "Are you all right?" she asked. The girl with big brown eyes that set the standard for just how much eye makeup a 6th grader could wear kept her steely gaze focused away from her teacher. She faced the trail, eyes cast downward. Tracy could be a crier, and Ms. Hatfield knew she had to neutralize the situation, whatever it was, and fast. "Honey, I'm sorry if the squirrel story upset you." The girl shook her head. "That wasn't it, Ms. Hatfield." The teacher felt relief wash over her. Good. It wasn't something she said. "What is it?" Tracy looked up with wide, frightened, almost manga eyes. "Are you sick?" the teacher asked. Tracy didn't say a word. She looked back down and with the tip of her purple boot lifted the feathery stalk of a sword fern. At first, Ms. Hatfield wasn't sure what she was seeing. The combination of a stench, far worse than anything emitted by skunk cabbage, and the sight of a wriggling mass of maggots assaulted her senses. Instinctively, she swept her arm toward Tracy to hold her back, as if the girl was lunging toward the disgusting sight, which she most certainly was not. It was like a mother reaching across a child's chest when she hit the brakes too hard and doubted the ability of the safety belt to protect her precious cargo. All hell broke loose. Carrie started to scream, and her voice was joined by a cacophony. It was a domino that included every kid in the group. Even Bully Cooper screamed out in disgust and horror. Angie Bowden yanked out her earbuds as if she was pulling the ripcord on a parachute. No one had ever seen anything as awful as that. Later, the kids in Miss Hatfield's class would tell their friends that it was the best field trip ever. Chapter 3. Birdy Waterman parked her red Prius on Olalla Valley Road behind a row of marked and unmarked Kitsap County Sheriff's vehicles. She pulled on her badly wrinkled raincoat, also red, from the passenger seat and called over to Deputy Gary Wilkins, who stood next to the main trailhead. At 26, he was a young deputy, and this kind of thing, a dead thing, was still new to him. He was a block of a man with square shoulders and muscular thighs. He nodded in her direction, and his gray eyes flashed recognition and anxiety at the same time. "Your turn?" he asked, already knowing the answer. Birdy shut the car door. It was her turn. The county had a PR nightmare on its hands the previous year when a coroner's assistant screwed up a homicide case. In an embarrassing and ultimately futile attempt to save himself, he put the blame on the sheriff's detectives and their evidence-gathering process. It was a colossal error that hadn't yet healed over when the coroner and the sheriff decided a working-together rotation was the solution to all of their problems. People in both offices could still recall the subject line of the email. "There's no I in team." It was an eye-roller of the greatest magnitude. Because of that memo and the weeks of touchy-feely training that ensued, Birdy was standing in the muddy parking strip while the nephew she barely knew was probably burning down her house, making that sad frozen pizza she'd offered as his best bet for a hot meal. She almost never visited crime scenes, but she was in the rotation when Ms. Hatfield called 911. "How's the family?" Birdy asked Gary, slipping on her coat as a seam in the sky tore just enough to send down another trickle of Pacific Northwest springtime weather. She picked her way across the little ridge that separated the forest entrance from Banner Road, a 9-mile thrill ride of 2-lane blacktop that hopped up and over the hills of the southernmost edge of the county. She wore street shoes instead of boots, because, distracted by her nephew's sudden appearance on her doorstep, she hadn't considered she'd be traipsing through the woods until she was halfway there. "Banner Forest. Stupid me," she thought. "Good. I mean, not really," Gary said. "Abby got a stubborn cold, which means I'm next," he went on, referring to his 2-year-old. Birdy liked Gary, and right then she especially liked that he didn't ask for advice on how to help his daughter get over her cold. She was a doctor, of course. She'd had the same training as any MD, but her patients had little need for a calm bedside manner. They were always dead. "What happened here?" she asked. "No one has really said anything to me, other than, you know, the kids apparently found part of a dead body down the trail. They were pretty freaked out." "I imagine they would be," Birdy said. She indicated the row of sheriff department cars. "Kendall here?" Gary tipped his head toward the dark, tree-shrouded, funnel-like opening of the trail that led deep into Banner Forest. "Yep," he said. "They're all down there by, and you'll love this, Croaking Frog." Birdy arched a brow and looked down the pathway. "What's that?" she asked. "The name of the trail," he said. Gary had found something amusing in the worst of circumstances. He'd make a very good deputy. "Croaking Frog?" she repeated, though she was pretty sure she heard him correctly. "Welcome to South Kitsap County," he said. "You'll find Kendall and the others about 100 yards down that way." Birdy followed his fingertip toward the rutted trail into the woods.
Kendall Stark was a homicide detective Birdy liked working with more than the investigators in her unit in the sheriff's office. That wasn't to say that Birdy thought others in the Kitsap County Sheriff's Department were any less competent at what they did. They were skilled investigators, no doubt about that. It wasn't because Kendall was the only woman, either. If that had been the reason, Birdy would never say so anyway. Saying so would surely invite more sensitivity training. And yet, if she'd been completely honest with herself, the forensic pathologist did believe that Detective Stark had an ability to empathize with a victim's family to a greater degree than some of her male counterparts. It wasn't solely her gender. There were plenty of women in law enforcement who were so cerebral, so clinical, that emotions were sealed behind a fortress of their own making. Birdy had trained with several at the University of Washington who were all about CSI and crisp white lab coats and heels that thundered when they walked down corridors, an obnoxious drumbeat announcing their impending arrival. Kendall was different from those women, Birdy thought, because she was a mother, and a good one. In Birdie's world, a good mother, and God knew she learned that little fact the hard way, had the ability to understand the loss and suffering of others and the hurt that becomes a festering wound. Those were the cases in which a child was murdered, the darkest, saddest of any that came across either woman's desk. The obvious truth about any homicide was that, no matter the victim's age, he or she had a mother. Kendall was where she needed to be, at the scene or with witnesses. Birdy needed to be in the lab, or at home with her nephew. Cross-training, she thought, was so irritating. She glanced at a trail map on a sheltered kiosk behind Gary, but it looked like a crudely executed rendering of a sack full of snakes. The forest was crisscrossed by a series of hiking and horseback riding trails that had lately been taken over by dirt bikers. Several trails, including tunnel vision, featured earthen ramps that sent bikers soaring into the air. When the forest was saved from development, the vision of the committee that had fought for it had been to see it used as a nature preserve, a hiking and horseback riding trail. Not a speedway for dirt bikes. Birdy wondered how a dismembered foot had turned up in Banner Forest. Birdy knew that cougars had been spotted there, as well as the notorious case in which a black bear mauled a man when his dogs frightened the mother bear's cubs. There were two lessons there. Never let a dog off its leash, and never, ever anger a mother bear. Birdy followed the muddy trail to the intersection of Tunnel Vision and Croaking Frog. The ground was damp from the rain, but so compacted by the dirt bikes that it wasn't as gooey as it might have been. Tire treads laced the pathway. As Birdy passed a no-hunting sign nailed to an old-growth cedar stump, another possibility ran through her head. Maybe a hunter accidentally shot a child? Thought a small figure in the woods was a deer? Deer were thick in that part of the county. Even with no-hunting signs posted all over the place, there were plenty of rule breakers, especially midweek when fewer people frequented the woods. As she drew closer to Croaking Frog, she recognized the voices of the Tex and Detective Stark. Kendall looked up. Her short blonde hair had grown out some and softened the angular features of her face. The spikiness was gone and the look flattered her. Even her deep blue eyes benefited from the change. "I wondered if it was your turn to be a team player," she said. Birdy glanced past the detective. A tech was hunched among the sword ferns. "There's no I in team," Birdy said, recalling the obnoxious training they'd all been forced to attend to ensure that mistakes would never happen again. "You make an ass out of you and me when you assume something," Kendall said with a sigh. "Thank goodness the ass that got us all into this mess got fired." Birdy was grateful for that, too. "No kidding," she said. "What have we got here?" "Not much," Kendall said. "No visible sign of cause?" she asked. It wasn't Kendall's job to determine what happened to any victim, of course, but that didn't stop most detectives in most jurisdictions all over the country from announcing what they were pretty sure had occurred. Kendall shook her head. "No, not that. What I mean is not much of anything." She pointed downward. "All we've got is a foot." Birdy wedged herself into the mossy space next to a human foot painted with a writhing mass of maggots. "I'm not eating dinner tonight," Kendall said. Birdy had seen worse.
There were far more hideous images etched onto the tissue of her brain than a mass of maggots on a dismembered foot. If she'd been asked to make a top five list of the worst things she'd ever seen, it would include the case in which a Silverdale mother held a toddler's face against the red-hot coils of an electric stove, killing her. That haunted her every now and then. Also, a case in which a Bremerton woman poured battery acid over her sleeping husband and seared out his eyes. He survived for 4 agonizing months in a Seattle burn unit before mercifully succumbing to his devastating injuries. But that wasn't the worst of them all. The most revolting case of all was that of a Port Gamble man who killed his wife and literally put strips of her flesh to dry on a clothesline behind one of the historic homes in the darkly charming town at the very northern edge of the county she served as the forensic pathologist. He sold her remains as jerky at a store in nearby Kingston. A maggot-infested foot? Piece of cake. I can't exactly say this is doing much for my appetite, Birdy said, though it really didn't bother her that much. Decay was a part of the cycle. It had its purpose. She saw the sense in how all things returned to the earth. She knew, for example, that the trees all around them had been fed by the decomposed flesh of animals and human beings. She moved closer. Lighting was intermittent. Saucers of illumination spotted the space from breaks in the canopy of cedars that rocketed skyward. She did a quick assessment while the investigative team pulled back. The foot was human. Small. And although it was hard to say for sure, it appeared that some of the toenails had been painted a lively shade of pink. Birdy looked up at Sarah Dorman, one of the crime scene techs who still held anger over the blunder that not only bruised the entire department, but, more crucially, let a killer go free. "I'm doing my job, Dr. Waterman." "I know that, Sarah." Sarah, with her long red hair and pale complexion, could never really hide her feelings. She looked back at the foot and scowled. "I don't make mistakes," she said. "Of course not. I'm not here to try to catch you making a mistake, Sarah. I'm here for the training protocol." Birdy took a short breath. She knew Sarah wasn't mad at her, but she'd been the first on the scene and no doubt had to put up with some boneheaded comment about the collection of evidence and who was responsible for what. "Now, will you brief me on what's been done? And really, Sarah, can you at least fake a smile? Our work is hard enough." The other deputies stepped back to give them some space, and more than likely to escape the stench. Birdy crouched closer. The wind blew and shifted the canopy. The foot under the fern glistened in the light. "Upon my arrival, deputies had already secured the scene," Sarah said. "Because of the wet trail and the likelihood that we'd lose any potential trace, probably lost any when the kids were here anyway, we've already photographed and searched the immediate area." "How immediate?" Birdy asked. Sarah kept her grim face. 25 yards. "That's a big area," Birdy said, with a tone that was more approving than questioning. Sarah lightened a little. "Right, but we wanted to go wide because of the weather and the, well, you know, the possibility that there might be other body parts nearby." "Good work. Find anything?" Birdy asked. "Not really anything we think is connected to this, but we did pick up a double mint gum wrapper, a used condom, and a couple of beer cans." "Somebody used this place for a makeout spot," Birdy said. Sarah shrugged a little knowingly. "Yeah, I mean, I grew up here and, well, yeah, kids probably." Birdy scanned the trampled scene. "Any footprints collected?" "Yes, a few," Sarah said. "But to be honest, things were pretty trashed by the time we got here. Lots of kids running around screaming and stuff. The teacher did her best to keep everyone away, but I have a feeling that a bunch of them got a good look at the foot." Birdy understood. "I know I would have." Sarah smiled for the first time. It was a genuine smile and not one offered up to soothe the feelings of those angry about the training session. "Good work, Sarah," Birdy said. Kendall, who'd been talking to another deputy, joined Birdy. When Birdy stooped down low, the detective followed her lead. Without saying a word, Birdy put on a pair of gloves. The two women held their breath and the forensic pathologist lifted a frond of the fern that had partially covered the ankle. It was too dark to see, so she crouched lower and took a small maglite from her bag. She turned on the flashlight and sent a beam over the maggots. In response, the mass writhed like the crowd doing the wave at a Seahawks game. "Can you tell how long the foot's been here?" Kendall asked. Birdy leaned in, almost close enough to touch it, though she never would have done that.
Hard to say if it is third or second molt, she said. We'll have to look at them back at the lab. Since we're all hovering here, I'm presuming this is all you have for me.
Search underway, Kendall said.
Who found the foot? Birdy asked.
A girl named Tracy Montgomery. She's a sixth grader in Suzanne Hatfield's class at Olalla.
Nature walk day, Birdy said, looking upward as the sun cracked through the sky, once more revealing the blue that reminded her of her father's faded chambray shirts, his practical uniform for the outdoor work he did in the summers.
Birdy grew up on the Macaw Reservation at the very tip of western Washington. Nature was always around her family. The woods were a second home. She turned to Kendall.
Did you talk to her?
Yes, Kendall said. She says she didn't get near it, didn't touch it. Her teacher confirmed her story.
All right, then, Birdy said.
She looked over at the tech.
Sarah, when you collect the evidence, I want the top 6 inches of soil. That sword fern, too.
What kind of square footage are we talking about? Sarah said, knowing full well that the word footage was probably on the edge of inappropriate. She hadn't meant it. It just came out that way.
4 feet all around, Birdy said, this time with a smile back at Sarah.
Sarah scrunched her brow and went to work with another tech. They finished taking photographs, carefully bagged the foot, and started on the soil samples. Each scoop of black, loamy dirt was tagged with coordinates inside a 4-foot grid that had been staked around the decomposing body part. Birdy walked along the trail, scouring it for any sign of who might have left the foot, or the body that had been severed from it. Kendall called over to her.
"You think a bear mauled someone?"
A piece of pale pink fabric caught Birdie's eye, and she motioned to Sarah to collect it.
"Don't know," she said.
"We had that mauling a few years ago," Kendall said.
"Right, right about that."
Birdy set a yellow collection marker by the fabric, a shred of nylon, probably an undergarment.
"I don't think so," she went on. "I think an animal would have dragged that foot to its den, or, even more likely, consumed it on the spot.
If there were any footprints, animal or human, they've been obliterated by the rain in Ms. Hatfield's class," Kendall said. Satisfied there was no role for her right then, and she'd followed the orders to be there, Birdy started down the trail toward her car.
"Let me know how the search goes," she said. "I'm heading back now. I have unexpected company and a foot to examine."
"You seem less excited by your company than by the maggot-infested foot," Kendall said.
"Who is it?"
Birdy turned around and looked at her friend. It was one of those looks that said far more than words.
"My sister's son."
Kendall blinked back with surprise.
"Your sister's? That's interesting. You almost never mention her. In fact, I didn't really even know you had a sister for the first year you were here."
"Don't get me started," Birdy sighed. "You don't have enough time to hear my family story."
"Try me sometime," Kendall said.
Birdy unbuttoned her raincoat and walked toward the light coming from the roadway. She knew the detective meant it. Kendall was a real friend, but Birdie's family baggage was of such serious tonnage that she barely could carry it, let alone see a need to drop it on the shoulders of someone she admired.
Chapter 4
Elon didn't come to the door to greet his aunt when she arrived at her place on Beach Drive. He stayed planted in front of the TV wearing the lilac bathrobe and a sullen look.
"If your friends could see you now," Birdy said, taking off her muddy shoes and making her way to his spot on the sofa.
"I don't have any friends," Elon said in a tone that sounded like he meant it and wasn't reaching for pity. Birdy picked up the remote control. She turned the sound down a little, not off, not on mute.
"Elon," she said, "we need to talk."
He looked at her and then over at the TV. It was some kind of action flick involving explosions and minimal dialogue. It seemed completely riveting to the teenager.
"I don't want to talk now," he said. "Is it that you don't want to talk now or talk at all?"
He shook his head a little.
"I don't know."
Birdy sat down. She was soggy, hungry, and she had to get back to work. She didn't have time to try to draw things out of him. She needed him to focus on what she was saying. She needed to know why he'd shown up like some uninvited pizza delivery boy. She clicked the remote control once more. This time she turned off the television.
Elin stared at the blank screen. Elin, she said.
Talk.
Aunt Birdy, he answered, his voice growing soft. I don't want to go home. Ever.
It was a start. Vague, but a start.
All right, Birdy said. You don't want to go home.
I understand that, Elin, but what I need to understand is why.
Why don't you want to go back?
The teen stayed silent.
I need to call your mother, Birdy said,
holding her exasperation to a minimum. She hated the idea of calling Summer. Their last few encounters had been less than cordial. There was always the lingering sting in Summer's comments that Birdy was selfish and preoccupied with her own life, her life away from the others, that dead people mattered more to her than her own living family members.
You think you're too good for us, don't you, sister?
Summer had asked the last time they spoke, a repeat of a conversation they'd had many times before. Birdy took a step back.
I never said that.
Summer pointed her index finger, one, like all of them, that was coiled with silver rings.
You inferred it.
Birdy smelled alcohol, but made no mention of it.
Implied is the word, Summer. But no, I didn't.
Summer threw her hands in the air. It was a showy move, but within the confines of her living room, where her husband, oldest son, and the family dog watched TV, it didn't spark the slightest bit of interest.
There you go again, Summer said, making all of us feel like we're stupid.
Birdy had heard that one before. Part of it made her angry. The same song, over and over. And yet the other side of the coin was that Summer didn't have to end up the way she had. She was intelligent. She was creative. She was all of those things when she was a teenager.
You could have gone to college, Birdy said. You were the smart one.
Summer didn't say another word. She had been disarmed by the truth, and she had nothing to do but accept what her sister had said. Summer had been at the top of the class. She was the sister who taught Birdy the joys of reading, of dreaming of a life beyond the reservation with its endless gossip, heartache, and futility. All of Summer's dreams evaporated when she dropped out of school, became a mom, got married, waffled on what she'd do. After that, Summer foundered like a wreck off the edge of Nia Bay. She never got her footing again. She never fulfilled the promise that her intellect had once assured. Instead, she drank, drifted, and watched from afar as Birdy escaped the reservation and the life there that was never going to be anything but hard.
Call her, Elin said, meeting his aunt's gaze. But I'm not going back. If you try to make me, I'll just run away. I'll go somewhere far away where no one can find me. And if I do, it will be your fault.
Birdy wasn't sure what she should do. She knew that while she and her sister had their differences, they did have a bond, a history that wasn't always so strained. There were things that kept them wound together, like the jute twine they'd used to make bracelets when they were kids.
Can't I stay with you? You have to be in school, for one thing. For another, I don't even really know you, Elin. I don't know how to take care of you. I'm 16. I don't want to go to school anymore.
Birdy didn't like that response at all. Education was the only way to a better life. She didn't want Elin to fail. She just couldn't have that happen. Even though Summer was older, she'd always felt that there was truth to her sister's insistence that Birdy had abandoned her when she left for the university in Seattle.
If you stay here, she said, you have to go to school.
Elin brightened a little.
You mean you might let me stay? Are you on drugs? She asked.
No, he said, his tone a little hurt. I mean, I smoke a little, but not much. Not like the crowd back home.
Birdy pressed him. How much is a little?
Once a week, maybe.
I don't have any with me if that's what you were worried about.
If you stay, it is only until the end of the school year.
Birdy could scarcely believe her own words, but her sister's complaints resonated. They were unfair, but they still hurt. She had gone away. She had created a new life outside the reservation. Maybe she owed Summer something? Even if Summer was harsh, mean, a bitch, she was her blood. So was Elin.
If I call her and tell her that it's all right for you to stay here, would that be okay with you?
she asked. Elin looked at Birdy. His eyes were so dark brown, they were almost black. They looked wet, pooling with tears.
Do you promise I can stay?
He wasn't going to cry. Elin was toughing it out. It might have been because he was a teenager and no teenage boy wants to fall to pieces in front of a grown-up. It might also have been that he'd been cried out. Something painful had forced him from his home to hers.
Yes, she said, on three conditions.
The boy looked hopeful.
What? You have to tell me why you're here.
I can't, he said.
Not now.
Birdy landed her hand softly on Elin's shoulder. She felt a slight tremble, and then he rolled his shoulder to shake her off.
Fine. But later you will, won't you?
I'll try, he said.
Promise?
I promise. Birdy got up and went to get her phone from her purse.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.